Good evening. By the way, that was just a special time of worship. Those were some of the loveliest songs I've ever heard sung at one of these conferences. They were just nourishing, and I appreciate very much the choice of those. I want to begin tonight with a missionary story. Missionary stories are meant, I think, in almost every case, to be emotional. And this, for me, is a particularly emotional missionary story. It's about a young woman named Nong. Now, with a name like that, you might suppose that she lives in Southeast Asia, which in fact is the case. And in fact, Nong lives in a closed country, one where traditional Christian missionary outreach is prohibited by law. But missionaries have found her nonetheless. And an American missionary who knows Nong personally has written about her, and he describes her as having a huge desire to learn about God, a desire like he's never seen before. You can imagine the joy of working with somebody like that. And she is filled with questions. She has a hungry heart, a hungry mind. But they're not the questions you would expect. For example, she asks the missionary about a pamphlet she received, which describes how Jesus moved from the holy place to the most holy place in the heavenly sanctuary in 1844. And she wants to know more about a coming law enforcing Sunday worship. So the missionary patiently answers Nong, and he explains that the two great errors employed by Satan in the last days will be the immortality of the soul and Sunday sacredness. He also explains to Nong that the early Sabbath keepers discovered the Sabbath truth, and the Lord confirmed their discovery through the visions of Ellen G. White. Now, the story of Nong is told in the glossy color magazine of Adventist Frontier Missions. And in fact, it is an organization dedicated to spreading the deeply heretical Seventh-day Adventist message among the world's so-called unreached people groups. And it illustrates just one aspect of the very disturbing missionary reach of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which we will get into in just a moment. But for due diligence, what are the missionary marching orders of Christ to his followers in Scripture? I think just about everybody here knows what they are, but I'd better say them anyway. We can start in Acts chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. Christ said to them, "It is not for you to know times or epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you, my disciples," he says, "will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest parts of the earth." And there's a companion command, isn't there? The Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28. Jesus comes up and speaks to them saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." But even when Jesus was still on earth, there were other missionaries on the march, as we're reminded in Matthew chapter 23, a passage that may be familiar to you as well, in which he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you cross land and sea to make one proselyte, one convert. And when you've done so, when he becomes one, you make him twice as much a son of hell as you are yourselves." Those are rather grim words, but they needed to be spoken. And so it is incumbent upon me, before proceeding into the depths of Adventist teaching, what is the good news? What is the gospel? What is the starting point for evaluating substitutes and counterfeits? which we are enjoined to do. Paul lays them out in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 to 5, in which he writes, I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which also you stand, and by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he then appeared to Cephas and to the 12 and to many others. This is the core gospel message. So when Paul is writing to the Galatians, for example, in the first chapter of his letter, that even if an angel from heaven should preach to them any gospel than the one that he has brought them, even if he himself should reappear one day and do such a wicked thing, that they are to pay no attention, that such a messenger is to be accursed. Indeed. So who's spreading the true gospel? One good example for us is the Southern Baptist Convention. I called them this morning to get some statistics, and it's very interesting. Their International Mission Board is supported by the 15.3 million members of the Southern Baptist Convention. That sends 3,600 missionaries onto the field at this time. That's divided between career and short-term missionaries. 3,600. Guess what that costs? Guess what their 2016 budget was? More than $250 million. Missionary work can be very expensive, and accountable organizations put those numbers out. But what about those who are not spreading the gospel, but who say they are? Can you think of any? I can. Let's think, for example, of our friends in Salt Lake City, the Mormons. They have 15.6 million members around the world, just a little more than the Southern Baptists have in the United States. And they have 74,000 full-time missionaries. In fact, it is the largest single dedicated full-time missionary force in the world. In the world. Of people who have no other job than to be missionaries. Pretty impressive. Mormon Church is now working in 188 languages. And we don't know how much they spend on their missions activities, but David Barrett, the famed missiologist, author of the World Christian Encyclopedia, estimated 25 years ago that the Mormons were spending more than $500 million a year on their missionary program. Some of you might be gifted with numbers. You can project what that would be worth in today's money. But it's pretty scary. And the Mormons are working in at least 153 countries. So a lot of bang for their buck. But wait, there's more. There's the Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, they seem to have a lot fewer members than the Southern Baptist Convention or the Mormons. They only have 8.3 million baptized members, but all those people are publishers. What's a publisher? That's a baptized witness who goes door to door, who's actively proselytizing. So guess what they get? They don't have 8.3 million members and then some missionaries on the side. They're all missionaries. You don't get counted unless you're basically a missionary, wherever you live or wherever they've sent you. This indeed is very impressive. They're also working in more than 500 languages, all of which are online. In fact, nobody out-translates and nobody out-publishes the Jehovah's Witnesses. Religious, commercial, governmental, they outpublish anybody. It's quite striking. And they're in more countries than any other cult. 240 nations and territories. Quite the bang for the buck. Needless to say, I was bound to bring up the Seventh-day Adventists. 19 million members. By most recent count. Guess how many missionaries they have, or interdivision employees and pioneers? Any guesses? out of the 19 million members, about 2,200. Yeah, that's how many they formally count. That's the figure they publish. Quite surprising to me. They're working just in their publications with 380 languages. If you count their oral work, it's almost 1,000. But they don't publish, or at least I could not easily locate their mission's budget. But even if they published one, it would not tell the whole story. And the Adventists are nearly as widespread as the Jehovah's Witnesses, operating in 215 countries. That's about 20 shy of the absolute maximum. As Ted Wilson said in 2011, the emphasis on mission is at the core of what the Seventh-day Adventist Church stands for. And judging by its activities, it's hard to reach any other conclusion. So I want to talk for a few more minutes about the Seventh-day Adventist missionary threat, which involves far more than mere statistics, far more than meets the eye. It's interesting looking back at the beginnings of Adventism that Uriah Smith said in 1859 that preaching the three angels' message outside of North America was really unnecessary. Now, this is a guy, of course, with a shut door still fresh in his memory. But why do that? Besides, foreigners were coming to North America, and he also opposed investing in foreign missions as long as there were any poor people here at home. However, just 5 years later, former General Conference President John Nevins Andrews was sent as the first official, not the first, but the first official Seventh-day Adventist missionary. He went to Switzerland, where he engaged in a vigorous publishing work in the French language. Didn't do much in terms of church development, but he published a lot. It was interesting to read that he had a pivotal role in Adventist theology and its development. And his statement about the purpose of his mission in Europe is as follows, quote, to preach the Sabbath, to warn the people of the coming judgment, and to call God's people to obey the immutable law of God, close quote. Well, isn't that good news? It's not surprising that he also vigorously opposed doctrines like the Trinity and the deity of Christ. Not a guy I'd want to spend the weekend with. But what are the Adventist distinctives today? What is the message now? The Seventh-day Adventist Church is very cozy with many other denominations on the missions field. It's quite surprising how chummy they are. But what is at the core of their preaching? One African Adventist writer in his dissertation says, the Adventist missionaries have never altered what they believed in their distinctive call, namely to preach Christ, Sabbath, and judgment to non-Christians, and to preach Sabbath and judgment to Christians. Isn't that good news? Central characteristics of the Adventist proclamation are belief in the imminent return of Jesus Christ and the observance of the Sabbath on Saturday. According to Adventist missiologist Stefan Herschele, very important author. And as you go through the Adventist missions literature, what's written by scholars and also popular authors, it is very clear that the traditional core distinctives of Adventism, despite the sugary stuff that you see for public consumption, is all there. The three angels' messages, the great controversy, the remnant. It's interesting, Ellen White calls those other churches that they're all chummy with on the missions field, doom churches. And of course, many references to the spirit of prophecy to substantiate anything you want. But if anyone is in doubt as to what the Seventh-day Adventist Church is preaching on the world's mission fields, in free countries and in closed countries, wherever they go, it's made very clear in their baptismal vows. Because somebody who's persuaded by the efforts of the Adventist missionaries must assent to a series of propositions in order to receive baptism. Not surprising, and according to the Church Manual of 2010, these include Do you accept by faith the righteousness of Christ, your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary? Do you believe that the gift of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the remnant church? Do you accept and believe that the Seventh-day Adventist church is the remnant church of Bible prophecy? Can you imagine? You want to be a follower of Christ, and you can't receive baptism. You can't go under the waters until you have agreed to these doctrines. The certificate of baptism and commitment is even more explicit on these points. And so this Adventist proclamation, even though you will go through their missionary magazines and go to their websites, they'll just talk about, we need to get Jesus to the people. That ain't the message. He's in there. He's in there, but he's only one cherry in the cocktail, as it were. Because, for example, I mean, the message is so dangerous because it's both deceptive and divisive. One of the first things that Adventist converts must adhere to, must embrace, is, of course, the Sabbath. And it's an automatic, non-negotiable wedge issue that even new converts are eager to proclaim and even debate with their biblical Christian friends, who are typically unprepared for the challenge. But the new Adventist is ready to go to war on that point. Adventism is divisive by nature. And yet consider, in the first century of Adventism's missionary work, they grew from just 6,000 to 2.4 million. And then to 20 million, nearly, today. And unlike Mormonism, which is really a hemisphere cult, most of the membership is in North America, or at least the Western Hemisphere here. 80% of Adventists now live outside of the U.S., and that's where the growth is happening, is outside of North America. In fact, from 1960 to 2010, that 50-year span, convert baptisms in the global South, as Philip Jenkins calls it, they tripled, reaching 96% of all baptisms in the Adventist Church. Under Ted Wilson, membership is growing at over 1 million per year. And you have ambitious, audacious, and effective evangelistic strategies. For example, in Venezuela, last year in April, they had more than 4,000 people baptized in a single day. But if that wasn't crazy enough, maybe you guys heard about Rwanda. Rwanda, over 110,000 baptisms in 1 month. Now, just to give you some perspective, how many is that? That's more than the total of all Seventh-day Adventists in the former Soviet Union. That's just crazy. And I mean, that just blew away the former record, which was 30,000 people in Zimbabwe in 2015. There's more than 1 million Adventists in Zambia alone. And the key to this, in many cases, seems to be something they call total member involvement. It's a model that requires intense mobilization across a whole spectrum of activities. And again, the results are undeniably impressive, which brings us to not only the Adventist message, but its methods. You have strength through stealth, as I call it, and acceptance through ecumenism. Now, some of you who've done a little reading on missions history are aware of the Edinburgh World Missionary Conference in 1910, which was a great catalyst for world missions among biblical Christians. Well, guess who was invited to the centenary gathering? The Adventists. And the reason given by the conference chair is pretty troubling to me. He says the Adventists were invited to participate because, quote, it has been recognized that Adventist missionaries have been making a very significant contribution to missionary work worldwide. Well, yeah, like so have the Mormons. Quote, Adventists can bring to the event their reflections on how their own movement has been influenced by the success of its missionary outreach worldwide. The diversity of nationality, race, and language. The Adventist vision for the future shape of mission will be particularly valued at Edinburgh 2010. This takes my breath away. Then you have, for example, in Ukraine, right now, for the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation, guess who's in the organizing group? The Adventists, champions of sola scriptura. Not. Then you have the Bible societies around the world. I mean, the head of the Bible Society in Uganda until not very long ago was a Seventh-day Adventist. I could go on. I could bore you. I could upset you. But let's stop there. But understand that proselytizing among Christians, not just rubbing up next to them or getting a warm welcome wherever they might go, proselytizing by Adventists among biblical Christians has never gone away. In fact, according to Marcelo Diaz and Wagner Kuhn in Ministry Magazine, very few Adventist missionaries are working where there are no or only a few Christians of any denomination. Wonder why? Well, actually, maybe some of you have heard of a guy named Bert Beach. And he writes that it is easier to evangelize, notice the word, evangelize Bible-accepting and Christian-following people than those who have another or no specific theology. That is why we often tend to direct our evangelistic endeavors toward our Christian cousins. Close quote. Like, gosh, guys, who could blame us? And note, even at this, to give them credit of a sort, they are moving far more aggressively into parts of the world where there is no majority Christian presence. In fact, they've established 6 global mission centers to reach out to Hindus and Muslims and seculars. I mean, they're developing very specialized, very sophisticated ways of relating to all of these folks. The world is just not enough. They've got to do everything. But we also have to consider this as we take in the dimensions of the Adventist missionary threat. Institutional depth and diversity. Now, again, we have 4 main areas in which they're doing this, in which they're excelling. First of them is publishing. And as I said, even in contrast with the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Adventists are doing a heck of a job. They have 62 publishing houses and branches around the world. Again, working in 380 languages. Just Adventist World Magazine is going out to more than 140 nations, 1.5 million copies every month, 7 languages, for free. Then you have education, which is one of the fastest growing sectors in Adventism now. Nearly 8,000 schools worldwide. You, of course, have the medical arm of the Adventist Church, 175 hospitals and sanitariums, 385 clinics and dispensaries, over 18 million outpatient visits during the last year of record. And then you have what might even be one of the scariest things, at least to me as a missions strategy person, the media centers. Adventist World Radio, AM, FM, shortwave, satellite, podcasting in 77 major language groups. Mormons can't touch that. Not even close. The Mormons haven't even gotten out of bed in the morning compared with that. Then there's the Hope Channel. Surely you've heard of the Hope Channel. It began in 2003, and now they broadcast around the world on 44 channels in 37 languages. But the thing that really kills me, and the thing that really makes it all work at such a high level, is the entrepreneurial outreach. These independent entities. Writing in Adventist Today, William Abbott says, Adventist outreach and mission has been largely opportunistic, eclectic, and relatively unfocused and uncoordinated. And yet, in the final analysis, it is the independence and flexibility of Adventist missions and missionaries that accounts for their remarkable success. And he gives examples. The Adventist entrepreneurial spirit is stronger than ever. Maranatha Builders, Share Him, 3ABN, Self-Supporting Schools, Amazing Facts, OCI, AWR, ASAP, Adventist Layman Services and Industries, AFM, AWA, David Gates Ministries, and countless other efforts. Some of them started on the umbrella of the groups I just mentioned. These people are doing publishing, they're doing broadcasting, they're doing overseas proselytizing. And again, Adventist frontier missions working among highly vulnerable populations in so-called closed countries are reaching out to 25 people groups in 21 countries. And they're responsive, they're innovative, they're using technology in new ways. They've developed something called one-day churches. Have you heard of these? Where they can throw together a steel frame and steel roof church. They can ship that stuff from the United States to a country like Rwanda, which just had over 100,000 baptisms, for $3,000 apiece. Just amazing. Just amazing. And it's just scratching the surface. So where does this leave us? Where does this leave us? The question looming over all of this is, why isn't the body of Christ aggressively addressing the Adventist missionary threat? I can only theorize, but I have 7 possibilities for you to consider and pray about. First, missions leaders and folks on the field just have not seen the doctrine for themselves. They have no idea how deceptive and destructive the core Seventh-day Adventist message is. Or they haven't seen the data. They have no idea of how boldly and rapidly Adventism is growing at the cost of biblical Christian missions work. Because these people are taking captives, spiritual captives. And is it hard to come out of Adventism? If millions and millions of people are coming to Adventism, how hard do you think it's going to be to get them out? And wouldn't it be better to keep them out in the first place? Missions leaders apparently haven't seen the data. Or, this is one I really don't like, but here we go, they haven't understood Acts in the epistles. That actively guarding the flock against spiritual predators is a central and non-negotiable dimension of the New Testament missionary enterprise. It's part of the job. Simple as that. Or perhaps they have a kind of misplaced fatalism, right? A sense that little or nothing can be done. So why try? You know, the cults you have with you always. Or they feel that countering cultic groups on world mission fields might require some kind of distasteful, dirty work. Something that would be somehow beneath their dignity or anything that Scripture really requires. Or maybe they believe that it's just enough to preach the gospel. Have you heard that one? And everything else will just sort itself out. A colleague of mine in Mexico said, "I just think they have hard hearts. That they could know about this at all and do nothing." So, in light of the foregoing, I challenge you in 3 areas. One of them is that we must pray, and specifically for this, because our struggle is not against flesh and blood, as I think just about everybody in this room realizes. We're not going to outnumber these people, we're not going to outspend these people anytime soon, but we can outpray them, especially because we actually know the person we're praying to. Pray for courage and clarity in confronting the errors of Adventism with unmistakable integrity and love. And my goodness, friends, if you don't do so every day, pray for the work of Life Assurance Ministries, the unique frontline work of Life Assurance Ministries. They are doing things that nobody else is doing. We need to pray. We need to warn people about Seventh-day Adventist methods and message. As Paul said to the Ephesian elders in Acts chapter 20, be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock. We need to talk to missionaries, denominational and parachurch leaders, pastors, lay believers. We need to cultivate a strong, reflexive, defensive posture like people have toward the Mormon and Jehovah's Witness missionaries. Even Christians who don't know much about much see the Mormons or the Jehovah's Witnesses and they say, ooh, not in my house. We know who those folks are. There's got to be a way that we can cultivate this kind of reflexive response. And many more people raise their awareness and their concern. Give those Adventist missionaries, who are undoubtedly many of them sincere and extraordinarily hardworking, but give them a bad reputation, as they deserve. But even at that, number three, we have to witness to them, don't we? We have to share the love of Christ with Adventists, as Paul wrote to Timothy in his second letter. I just love this passage. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, the Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wronged, with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition, like these legions of Adventist cross-cultural missionaries. If perhaps God may grant them repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. Brothers and sisters, in closing, I'll say it again. The evidence is here. The evidence is clear. And not just because I said it. We must answer the Adventist missionary threat for the sake of Christ, for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of generations yet unborn, for the truly defenseless ones, for Nong.